Welcome. Hello there. My name is Joel. I serve as one of the pastors here at Panama Baptist Church. Thanks for being with us. This is normally the time when we do our announcements, but you know, we don't have a lot of announcements right now. So let me just take time to mention our emails that come out Tuesday and Thursday. Tuesday focuses on prayer requests, prayer needs that we have among the church family. Thursdays is when we do cover all of the announcements that we have, some of the things that we say here at our gatherings, but also things that we don't take time to actually talk about. So if you don't want to miss out on anything that's happening, the email list is the place to be. If you're not on that already and you want to be, send us an email, office@panamabaptist.org. We'll make sure you get on the right list. I'll also just take a moment to mention these invite to listen cards. This is just something we periodically remind you about. It's got all the church information on one side and our service information, you know, the times that we gather, things like that, on the other side. It's in a handy a business card size. There, these are great little tools. You're talking to somebody about church and you wish you had something you could put in their hand to let them know about Panama Baptist Church. We have these down in our church lobby. Grab a stack of them next time you're in. Keep them in your car, your wallet, your purse, wherever you might find it handy. If you don't come to the church building, but you'd still like some of these, again, send us an email. We'll be happy to mail a few of them to you. Okay, that's it as far as announcements. Let me pray, and then we'll turn it over to the music team to sing. Would you pray along with me? Let's do it. God, we are grateful for the time that you've given to us to gather, the technology that allows us to do things like this. I pray for Pastor Andy as he comes to continue his series in the book of Mark here in a few minutes, that you would give him just the words to say, that he would be able to communicate effectively and clearly. I pray for those who are watching this video, God, that they would be aware of your presence in their life, that you would put people around them to encourage them and give them just what they need right when they need it. In your name we pray. Amen. All right, here's the music team.
Standing on this mountaintop, looking just how far we've come, knowing that for every step you were with us. Kneeling on this battleground, seeing just how much you've done, knowing every victory was your power in us. Scars and struggles on the way, but with joy our hearts can say, yes, our hearts can say. Never once did we ever walk alone. Never once did you leave us on our own. You are faithful.
This is part two in our series in the book of Mark. We ended part one with a homework assignment. I hope you did that. If not, I really want to encourage you to go back and do the homework assignment I gave at the end. It really will be well worth your time. I promise you that. Let's get started in part two. Have you ever said, "I saw that coming"? If you did, why did you say that? I mean, how is it that you saw that coming? You don't have a crystal ball, right, or anything like that. So how did you know that that was coming, and that led you to say, "Oh, I saw that coming"? What was going on? Well, you probably said that because the course of action that you were observing had a very predictable, possibly certain outcome. You were observing, you know, action A, B, C, maybe there's a pattern or whatever. And it's just obvious. If you do these things, you're going to get those results, right? You saw it coming. Well, Mark has described for us in his book that there's been this persistent pattern of opposition to Jesus by the religious leaders. And there's been a pattern of persistent unbelief by many people. And Jesus has already stated three times that he's going to be rejected and killed soon. So there's all this opposition to Jesus, rejection of Jesus. What is the predictable, possibly certain outcome of all that? What, right? You don't have to be super genius to know. Well, if there's all this rejection of Jesus and opposition to Jesus, then man, judgment upon that generation would be the expected thing. You could say, man, I saw that coming, right? So what's at the root, though, of all this disbelief, this rejection, opposition? I mean, why? Was it just like intellectual, like they couldn't put together the pieces and see how it all fit and Jesus was matching up with the prophecies? Was it that, or was it something else? That's something we're going to try to answer by time we're done and are together today. We left off part one with the arrival of the king. Mark 11, verse 11. He went into Jerusalem, into the temple. After looking around at everything, since it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. We believe that was Sunday, Monday. Mark 11, verse 12. The next day, when they went out from Bethany, he was hungry, and seeing in the distance a fig tree with leaves, he went to find out if there was anything on it. When he came to it, he found nothing but leaves, for it was not the season for figs. So he said to it, "May no one ever eat from you again." And the disciples heard it. So this is Monday. Now Tuesday, chapter 11, verse 20. Early in the morning, as they were passing by, so they left Bethany, they're heading back to Jerusalem again on Tuesday, they saw the fig tree withered from the roots up, and Peter remembered and said to him, "Rabbi, look, the fig tree that you cursed has withered." Okay, there's a lot going on here, but what is going on here, right? Well, I did some research on this, and I read that trees in Jerusalem got leafy in March and remained leafy for approximately 9 months, but they don't produce fruit until June. And notice that Mark calls attention to the fact that this wasn't the season for figs. So you got to wonder, like, what's going on here? Is this a stress response? Right? Has the stress finally gotten to Jesus, you know? And so he just wants figs. And even though it's not reasonable to expect it, it's not the right season, he sees the leaves and doggone it. Is it that? Is it Jesus acting out? Or is Jesus teaching through symbolism? Like, is Jesus being intentional? Well, Jesus was always intentional about what he did. So this is definitely the latter. The other thing, the big clue we have, is that as Jesus made sure that the disciples heard him pronounce the judgment on the tree. So what's going on here? What does the tree and the curse all symbolize? Well, the cursing of the fig tree symbolized the coming judgment of the religious system. Rodney Cooper wrote, "Perhaps the best interpretation is that Jesus, in his omniscience, saw that this tree would never produce fruit, so he used the occasion to teach the disciples. The tree, which looked so promising because it was full of leaves, was fruitless, and the religious system of that day, the temple and the sacrifices and the festivals and all that went with it, the religious system looked so promising, right? There was talk about God there. There was prayer there. There were sacrifices there. There were priests. There was activity. It all looked so promising, but it wasn't going to produce fruit. What's the fruit? True worshipers of God. The religious system was producing not true worshipers. It was producing hypocrites. It was producing Pharisees, people who were more concerned about how they looked than how they actually were with God. So this religious system was leafy, right? It was green. There was a lot of activity there. It looked very religious, but it wasn't producing fruit, nor could it satisfy the spiritual hunger of the people. It gave them something to do that was, again, very religious, but it wasn't giving them the relationship with God that God intended. And so Jesus, through cursing the tree, is showing what he's about to do with that religious system. So like I said, the temple and the Jewish religious system are about to lose their right to represent God to the world. And that second day on Tuesday, the disciples walk by and they notice, man, the tree you cursed yesterday is dead today. That complete and quick death of the tree illustrates that this coming judgment is absolutely certain. It's going to be complete. It's going to be quick. And it's from the bottom up. It's done, right? There's no getting away from it. By the way, as a quick aside, Peter mentioned, hey, wow, look, it's dead already. Jesus used that opportunity not to talk about the judgment. I think the disciples already understood what the symbolism was all about. Instead, he used that moment to talk to them a lesson about not being surprised by answered prayers. That's a separate lesson from the lesson of the cursed tree. So they got kind of a twofer, right? They got the lesson about expecting God to answer your prayers and the lesson of the cursed tree, which is that the judgment is coming on the Jewish religious system. All right, back to our story. Let's go back to Monday and the timeline right after the tree is cursed. Verse 15, they came to Jerusalem, and he went into the temple, and he began to throw out those buying and selling. And he overturned the tables of the money changers and the chairs of those selling doves, and would not permit anyone to carry goods through the temple. And he was teaching them, it is written, my house will be called a house of prayer for all nations, but you've made it into a den of thieves. So first, boom, I mean, this is quite a day, isn't it? Jesus cursed a fig tree for something he didn't do, and then he made a whip and drove businessmen out of the temple who had a right to be there. The guys who are selling there had gotten permission from the high priest to do that. So again, is this stress getting to Jesus, or is this intentional behavior? It's intentional behavior. Notice a couple things are going on. First, the challenge to the authority of the high priest, right? The high priest has given people permission to take a shortcut to get to the other side. They go through this court of the Gentiles, the outer part of the temple. They have permission to do that, and they have permission to sell stuff in this area and stuff. And Jesus is challenging that authority. Did you catch the words? He says, my house, it's written, my house will be called a house of prayer. My house. This is my house. Maybe as a parent, you've said those words, not my house, right? And what you do, you're emphasizing not just that you pay the mortgage, but that you have the authority here. And Jesus is doing that. He's throwing out those who had permission from somebody else to be there, but saying, this is my house. And clearing out the temple, Jesus is addressing several things. One is the authority issue I just mentioned. The second is this, though. He's confronting the problem of the location of the selling and the hindrance that it was to worship and prayer. See, the selling is taking place in the court of the Gentiles. The Jews could go in a little farther into the temple. Gentiles couldn't. The only part where Gentiles are allowed to enter is this section, and it is now turned into an open-air market. When we lived in Portugal, we saw open-air markets. They're crazy places, confusing places, loud places. Sometimes you got people yelling like what they're selling and stuff like that, and there's just people going everywhere. And of course, at the markets there in Portugal, sometimes there's livestock. That was certainly the case here at the temple. So can you imagine, you're a Gentile, and you want to know God. You want to worship God, or you want to pray to God, and you believe that the center of it all, the closest you can get to God is to go to the temple. And so you want to go there because you need to talk to God, you need to pray, and you get there, and the part that you're allowed to go into, where you have to do your worship, and where you're going to attempt to pour out your heart before God for whatever it is you need, is an open-air market. It's a livestock market, and there's people crazy, and people are going through, and there's, oh, excuse me, and people bumping in, and you're trying to talk to God and pour your heart to God and worship God there. Yeah, that doesn't work real well, is it? No. And so it makes you wonder, like, why did the priests allow this? And we don't know. This is speculation on my part. My guess is, you know, perhaps there was some money involved, right? Perhaps they were charging a fee for the right to be there, because location is everything. It might have made it more convenient for the Jewish people that, you know, you didn't have to bring anything. Everything you needed was right there. And so it might have been more convenient for them. You buy what you need for your worship right before you go into your section, even though that makes it harder for the other guys, the Gentiles, to worship. I'm not sure. But this we know, Jesus wanted the temple to be a house of prayer. You saw what he said, for all nations. Even before he died for your sins, friends, Jesus was fighting for your right to worship God. We don't talk a lot about the right to worship God. We talk about rights a lot in our culture, but Jesus fought for your right to worship God. That just really struck me as I was working through this series, and I'm like, wow, Thank you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. I'm a Gentile, and I am so grateful that you are concerned about my ability to worship you and even my right to worship you. Thank you, Father. Perhaps that strikes you as well. Well, it certainly struck the attention of the chief priests. This is verse 18. The chief priests and the scribes heard it and started looking for a way to kill him. But they were afraid of him because the whole crowd was astonished by his teaching. So whenever evening came, this is Jesus and the disciples, would go out of the city. The chief priests are looking for a way to kill him. A lot of irony in the last few chapters of the book of Mark. Here's one that was pointed out to me in one of the books I read. Their plot, the religious leaders' plot to kill Jesus, will be used by God as the means to open a new place to worship God. See, right now the Gentiles could only worship God by going to Jerusalem and going to the court of the Gentiles, where it was hard to worship God. But after the resurrection of Jesus, the temple system is going to be done away with, right? It was gone. And where's the temple now? In our hearts, right? Paul points that out to us. He says, don't you know you are the temple of God? The Holy Spirit lives within you. And so as a result, the irony of it all is they're going to try to kill Jesus. Jesus uses his death and resurrection to be the means by which worshiping God becomes easier than ever for the Gentiles. And literally millions of Gentiles will indeed do just that. They will be the temple of God and worship God, you and I among them. Let's continue with the story. Mark 11, verse 27. So they came again to Jerusalem. It's now Tuesday, Jesus and disciples. As he's walking into the temple, the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders came and asked him, by what authority are you doing these things? And who gave you this authority to do these things? No doubt referencing the clearing out of the temple the day before. Jesus said to them, I'll ask you one question. Then answer me, and I'll tell you by what authority I do these things. Was John's baptism from heaven or of human origin? Answer me. Well, they discussed it among themselves. If we say from heaven, then why don't you believe him? But if we say of human origin, they were afraid of the people because everyone thought John was truly a prophet. So they answered Jesus, we don't know. And Jesus said to them, neither will I tell you by what authority I do these things. Listening to the deliberation of the chief priest sounds a little bit like the Vicini there in the Princess Bride, right? I can clearly not choose the wine in front of you, and they can't choose it in front of me. That's the boat they're in. They clearly can't say, John's baptism was originated in heaven. God told him to say that message because, what are they going to say? God sent the messenger and the prophet, and we rejected him, and we have no good reason, right? And they clearly can't say, well, no, John wasn't a prophet. God didn't tell him to say those things. No, because everybody believed with all their heart that John was a prophet. And so, that wasn't going to fly. What was their end game? When they're asking Jesus about this authority, like, all right, whose authority are you using here? Who gave it to you? What's their end game? What are they up to? Well, it's important to note that Jews believe that only Moses got his authority directly from God. And since then, all the prophets, all the priests, their authority came because it was passed down. So Moses gave authority to the priests, and that priest passed it to the next high priest, who passed it to the next high priest, and so on. And so what they're asking is, Jesus, you're acting as if you have authority, but you don't, or at least they don't believe he does, because you're not part of the group that it was passed down to, and surely, Jesus, you wouldn't be so crazy, so bold as to claim that you got your authority from God like Moses did, because that would put you on the same level of prophet as Moses, and we know that's not true about you, right? What they wanted, here's their end game, they wanted to get Jesus to claim divine authority, which oddly enough he had, right? But they didn't believe he had, so they wanted him to claim divine authority so that they could arrest him on charges of blasphemy, which eventually they do a little while later. But Jesus, he's so in control. He's so intentional, so in control. He withheld the full disclosure of his identity to them until he was good and ready. If they wanted to know who he was, they could have been out there with the whole donkey ride, right, when he proclaimed his king. Quick timeout. You remember the purpose of Mark's gospel is he wants you and me to have the evidence that we need in order to make the decision, am I convinced that Jesus is the Son of God? And so Mark has been telling us stories, not just any stories, true stories about Jesus, the things he did and what was done about to him and what he said and all that. So you might want to, just in your own time, think through, how do these stories fit? Like the fig tree story and the temple confrontation story. How do these stories serve as evidence that Jesus is the Son of God? Interesting to think about, and you might want to do that on your own time. So a few weeks ago, speaking of stories, I had an opportunity to meet with a small group of high school students from Sherman Central School, and I told them a story that I had kind of made up for them. I said this, imagine that you built a four-wheeler, right? You had some parts from this place and from there, and then you ordered and stuff, and you built a four-wheeler. You watched some YouTube videos, got it all together. You build this four-wheeler, and it is not, when it's done, it's no piece of junk. This is a nice, nice piece of equipment. It's got a little more power than would be standard. It is a nice piece of equipment, and you've painted it all up. It is an awesome four-wheeler, so much so that other people have seen you riding it, and a couple of your friends want to borrow your four-wheeler. So you, being the nice person you are, you decide to let them borrow this four-wheeler that you built. And you let them, but the deal is that they need to gas it up and they need to get it back to you by the weekend. So you let them borrow the four-wheeler, off they go, they're happy, you're okay, you're happy too, I guess, because you're a nice person and you're letting your friends borrow. Friday night comes and no four-wheeler. They don't bring it back to you. So you text them like, hey, you know, I remember the deal and I'm going to go out and be doing some things this weekend. I need my four-wheeler back. You get no response. Saturday, you send several texts, but all throughout the day, there's no response. You respond, you text the first friend, the second friend, all three friends, you text them, no response from any of them. Sunday, another friend of yours happens to see them out riding the four-wheeler and reminds them, like, hey, weren't you supposed to get that four-wheeler back to, you know, right? And so your friend reminds these guys that they're supposed to have the four-wheeler back to you. It doesn't come back Sunday. Monday, you see them in school and you talk to them and you're like, hey, what's good? And they don't really answer you. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, each day you remind them, look, you've got to get this four-wheeler back to me tonight. Do it today. You know, we're not waiting till another weekend. Today, no response, no four-wheeler. Friday, you just show up at their house to get your four-wheeler. And to your shock, they refuse to let you have your own four-wheeler. And one of the guys goes so far as to threaten to kill you if you ever come back demanding your four-wheeler. What in the world? I mean, this is messed up. You need, by the way, if this was true, you need new friends, right? Because these guys are not good friends. You come back later to ask one more time. This time you've got your phone on you, but kind of hidden so you can record it. And they refuse and they beat you up. Not cool. Now imagine, let's add another piece to this story. Imagine that your dad, to us, these students in Sherman, imagine that your dad is the local judge and he has a whole bunch of state trooper friends. Oh, by the way, to happen to mention your dad is really big, right? Not big as in like pudgy, like boom, buff. And he has a whole bunch of state trooper friends. How does this story end? Yeah, you're getting your four-wheeler back and they're getting something too, right? Jail time, right? Something on their record. This story that I told these high schoolers is a lot like a story that Jesus told. Mark chapter 12, verse 1, he began to speak to them in parables. A man planted a vineyard and put a fence around it. He dug out a pit for a wine press, built a watchtower. Then he leased it to tenant farmers and went away. At harvest time, he sent a servant to the farmers to collect some of the fruit of the vineyard from them. But they took him, beat him, and sent him away empty-handed. Again, he sent another servant to them, and they hit him on the head and treated him shamefully. Then he sent another, and they killed that one. He also sent many others. Some they beat, others they killed. He still had one to send. a beloved son. So finally he sent him to them, saying, they will respect my son. But those tenant farmers said to one another, this is the heir. Come, let's kill him, and the inheritance will be ours. So they seized him, killed him, and threw him out of the vineyard. What then will the owner of the vineyard do? He will come, kill the farmers, and give the vineyard to others. The story that Jesus told, which is like the story that I told, is a lot like what was actually happening. The people that Jesus told the story to claimed that Jesus wasn't God and therefore had no authority to tell them anything, certainly not to tell them what to do. Jesus pointed out that as the vineyard owner, he had the right not only to tell them what to do, but to expect fruit. So earlier, I asked this question right at the beginning of our time. What was the root of all this disbelief, rejection, and opposition? I mean, why are the miracles that unconvincing, right? Is the testimony of the people whose lives were changed, of people who had the demons kicked out, was that unconvincing? Why are these folks refusing to believe? Why are they rejecting Jesus? And why is there so much opposition? Authority issues. They have authority issues. Frankly, they want to be in authority. They think they deserve to be in authority because of their position or because of their knowledge or because of how faithful they've been and fulfilling all the rules. They think that they are special. They think they deserve to have authority. And here comes somebody who's challenging their authority, and they have authority issues. This story that Jesus told was a warning to them. It was a warning, not just the like, oh, hey, don't touch the stove kind of warning, you know, because it's hot and you burn your little fingers, right? This story was a warning meant to save their lives and to save their right to represent God to the world. But when they heard the story, they got mad. Right? They got mad, furious when they heard the story. And eventually, as we find out, as you read through the rest of the book of Mark, they killed Jesus. And then if you read history after that, they were eventually executed by Roman armies. This story was a warning meant to save their lives and to save their right to represent God to the world. They lost that too. The right to represent God to the world was given to other people, Jesus followers of every nation. The temple system came to an end. So I told a story. It was a little like Jesus' story, but Jesus' story was like what was actually happening. The story that Jesus told might be a lot like what's happening in your life. The old heart. If you're a Jesus follower, you have two hearts. You have the old heart and the new heart. If you're not a Jesus follower, you only have the old heart. You don't have the new one yet. The old heart has authority issues. It does. The old heart has authority issues. It does not accept well. It does not like anyone telling it what to do. The old heart, not only that, tends to ask the wrong question when confronted by God. When God starts getting into the face, so to speak, of the old heart and starts leaning in like, this is what's right, this is what's wrong. This is what you ought to do, this is what you not ought to do, right? The old heart tends to ask the wrong question. It tends to ask this: God, what right do you have to? And you fill in the blank. And by the way, when the old heart asks that question, God, what right do you have to? It's not actually asking a question. It's actually making a statement, right? The statement is, God, you have no right. Or I'm not going to acknowledge your right. You might think you have a right, God, but I don't acknowledge that. The old heart has a tendency to ask the wrong question. God, what right do you have to blah, blah, blah? Instead of, is God getting what he rightfully deserves from me? That's what the vineyard owners, the vineyard farmers should have been asking. What does the owner rightfully deserve from me? That's not what they are asking. They're asking, how can I kill off the owner so I can have it all to myself? The old heart does that. How can I get rid of God so that I don't have to acknowledge his authority? How can I get rid of God and any conscience or guilty feelings or whatever? How can I get rid of God so that I can do what I want? And instead of asking, is God getting what he rightfully deserves from me? That's what the old heart does. Friends, never underestimate the old heart and the authority issues it has. It's never reformed. It never goes away. Praise God, if you're Jesus' follower, you have a new heart to help offset that. If all that is true, if authority issues are behind so much of our opposition and our tendency to reject and our even our disbelief, then self-examination is in order. And I'm going to end with just three questions. Is there any part of my life that I won't let God have authority over? Is there any part of my life that I won't let God have authority over? I won't let him tell me what to do. Second self-examination question is this. Is God getting from me what he rightfully deserves? What does God rightfully deserve? My trust and my good works. Is God getting from me what he rightfully deserves? My trust and good works. Or am I giving God the cold shoulder, like pretending he doesn't exist, like he's not there, or worse, actively pushing him away, cursing him, whatever that might be. And then third self-examination question I have is this. How will my story end? Jesus lovingly told these guys who were pushing back and rejecting and just nasty, a story, a warning, so that their story could have a different ending. They refused. Am I being warned? Am I being warned? And so how will my story end? We'll pick up here in part three.
Thank you, Pastor Andy. I found last week's start to the series of Mark very beneficial and challenging and encouraging. I'm finding this one the same way. I trust you are as well. I'm looking forward to the rest of this series. Let me close with this verse, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 58. Therefore, my beloved brothers, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. Thanks for being with us. If we can be of any help to you, just someone to talk to, you've got questions about things that you've heard, you need somebody to pray for you, please don't hesitate to reach out to us here at the church office. We'd be honored to talk to you. In the meantime, we'll see you next week, Panama Baptist Church. You are deployed.